Sometimes you gotta bleed to know that you're alive and have a soul. But it takes someone to come around to show you how. She's a tear in my heart. I'm alive. She's a tear in my heart.
Good morning. You are listening to Inside the News on Taboo Conspiracy on Thursday. It is 6 minutes after the hour, and we have with us today Mark Sargent. And the question we are addressing today is, are we inside a Truman Show enclosed world thousands of miles wide? Growing up on South Whidbey Island, Washington, Mark Sargent started his career playing computer games professionally. You're my hero already, Mark. From there, he spent the next 20 years training people in proprietary software. In 2014, he looked into what is no doubt the most ridiculous conspiracy ever. The most absurd as well. Called Flat Earth Theory, and through extensive research, he discovered that it wasn't really so laughable after all. Yet my chosen reaction to the majority of this stuff is just to laugh, like, you've got to be kidding me. Early in 2015, he released a series of YouTube videos entitled Flat Earth Clues, which delves into the possibility of our human civilization actually being inside a Truman Show-like enclosed system. This is absolutely ridiculous. But also how it's been hidden from the public since 1956. Mark, thank you so much for being on the show.
Thank you very much for having me, and good morning.
Good morning.
This is too much fun.
Yeah.
Why did you ever start looking at fringe ideas like this, Mark?
This particular idea I looked at because last summer I was kind of bored. I had looked at conspiracies for years and years and years, ever since the movie JFK came out in the early 90s. And this one was always on my shelf, not literally, of course, but I always knew it was there, and I didn't look at it like any other conspiracy person because it's ridiculous, it's ludicrous, it's madness. And one day I happened to stumble across a YouTube video by a German guy who was ranting in German text about how all the flights in the Southern Hemisphere were wrong. And I thought, well, that's interesting. Maybe I'll take a look at that. And
what was it in the Southern Hemisphere that was wrong?
Oh, the flights. He said they were taking all these weird routes, anything from South America to like Australia. It didn't make sense to him. And I go, okay, that's, you know, he goes, it doesn't work on a globe, the flights that are down there. I was going, okay, that's fine. So I'll look into it a little bit. And then I ran into this video by a guy named Matt Boylan, who claimed that when he was 25, he's a little older now, that he was recruited by NASA to do photorealistic artwork for some backdrops of theirs. And that wasn't even a big deal. He wasn't pointing at anything during that. But during that interview, he was saying that during a high-level party on the East Coast, he was told, there was this discussion that he was told the GPS, the global positioning system, didn't work down in Antarctica. And the conversation, you know, kind of went down the lines of, well, why doesn't it work down there? It's like, well, because it's flat. And he didn't get it. He completely didn't understand it. It took years for him to kind of decipher it as well. So what happened, I tried to really debunk that story. I was going, well, this can't be. You know, it's ridiculous. We all know it's a globe. And over the course of 9 months, from last summer up until about February of this year, as a matter of fact, what we're talking about now, people are going, well, how is this a topic? It wasn't a topic in January really of this year. I mean, yeah, there was a few people out there covering it. But I basically flipped from debunking it for 9 months to just caving in and says, you know what? I can't prove it's the globe anymore. There's nothing out there that conclusively tells me this. So I made a series of clues, little short YouTube videos called Flat Earth Clues, and I put them out on YouTube, and I was kind of hoping that somebody would step forward and say, okay, here's why it's a globe, here's the absolute proof. You can just shut up now and go back to your normal, regularly scheduled life. And here we are in November, and it not only is it not turned into, not turned back into a globe, but I've done like 40 interviews since then, and got my own little radio show, and you know, TV people have been sniffing around. It's been getting really, really weird, all because no one can answer the question. And you'd think we could. That's the riddle I put out to everybody. I said, tell me how you know it's a globe. And then I follow that with, don't tell me what you read. Don't tell me what picture was handed to you. Tell me how you know it's a globe.
That's a good way to go at it.
Yeah, and people always have that weird knee-jerk reaction, just like I did. It's like, well, duh, we know. That's always the first reaction. I go, yeah, but how do you know? Do you know because you saw a globe in your classroom when you were in first grade?
Yes, exactly.
or do you know?
I grew up with it.
Yeah, well, of course, we grew up with it. And I go, yeah, that's great and all, but how else do you know? They go, well, we saw the picture from NASA.
My father did this show for 20 years, Monday through Friday, on this hour and this station. And one of the main subjects conspiratorially that he covered was Planet X. So this guy's obviously got an open mind. Yet,
sure.
As soon as I was introduced to these ideas, I went to him in the kitchen in our office. And he's standing there, you know, we're having lunch. And I just say to him, Dad, the Earth's flat, man. From what I have read so far, there's no way I can prove it's a globe. And he goes, Josh, the reason why they know it's a globe is because when the ships sail out into the harbor, they disappear out of view. And this is, this is the answer from one of the most open-minded, intelligent people I know. So yeah. even from that brain, from that standpoint, it's still looked at something very, it's looked at as extremely absurd.
Absolutely. It is the only, and people listening out there, you got to understand this, and you got to ask yourself why, it is the only conspiracy we debunk to children. We don't talk about anything else to children about anything, you know, not even throughout any of the education process. We don't do this, but what we do is we put a globe in their classroom, and that's all the conditioning they need. By the time you get out of high school or whatever schooling you finish, that's it, you're in, and you are completely, it is the finest brainwashing ever, and it's done very, very well.
It's like extremely efficient its totalitarian. Like it's so total, your conditioning at that point. Just from a globe in your classroom.
I got to the point, I wasn't kidding.
Weirded me out.
And I've looked at every kind of conspiracy. I wasn't kidding in the clues when I said, look, I have looked at conspiracies where that say that every one of the royals, one of the royal family, is lizard people, and that didn't bother me. But when I clicked on my, I remember vividly when I tried to click on my first flat Earth video, I was visible. I got physically flushed, like a adverse reaction physically. I was, you know, I was like my blood pressure was going up, and I was embarrassed. I was like, wait a minute, why am I embarrassed? I'm a conspiracy guy.
Right.
You shouldn't be embarrassed by anything. And this one's so simple, right? It's not like we're talking about, you know, child killing, ritual sacrifice, or you know, aliens probing people or anything weird or graphic. It's just flat Earth theory. And in fact, here's the other clue you want to give at people. And that is, look, I can talk to people about the Truman Show and Enclosed World and Enclosed. Yeah, I can talk to people about the Truman Show for 20 minutes straight without even, you know, they don't even blink, right? The second I say flat Earth, the second I say it, all of a sudden people, you know, their eyes start, you know, going into defensive mode, and they physically will brace against it. And you got to wonder why. And I know why. It's because it was the conditioning. I fell into it. Look, when people are out there saying, no, it can't be, and I go, that's how strong it is. I tried to debunk this thing for 9 months, and I was in that denial mode. I am stubborn. And I was in that denial mode for the longest time. And now, after all the stuff that I researched, I come back at everybody and go, fine, tell me how you know it's a globe now. Prove it to me. Don't tell me. Don't throw a textbook in front of me. Tell me how you know it's a globe, and then ask why you do not personally know any more than that. And it's because it's been sealed off from you, and it's the greatest con of all time. I love it. It's been just pretty much my obsession now for the last 9 months.
Mark, are you ready to take a call already? Because this is a really popular subject, bud.
Throw them at me.
All right. Well, they're going to have to call back.
That's okay.
Here you go. Caller, what's your name?
Hi,
what's your name?
Stella.
Stella, why don't you ask Mark your question? Go ahead.
Look, I haven't researched it as much as I need to. I'm an earth science major myself and have had some questions. But, hey, quick question. Flight from France that had to stop in Utah. why is it flying from L.A. across the U.S.? Why didn't it go across the Pacific?
Right. Which one was it? Is this very, very recently?
Yeah, there was a plane that was grounded here in Salt Lake City that had a... Why was it grounded?
This terrorist action stuff, the horrible stuff.
Oh, you mean why was it going the opposite? Why was it going the opposite direction? Unfortunately, there was a power outage up in the Northwest, and so I have missed all the news for the last 24, 36 hours.
Oh.
We just got our power back. But my question is,
wouldn't they fly from L.A. across the Pacific to go to France?
To go to France from L.A.?
That seems like the longer way around to me.
That is the longer way. But I got a better one for you, because this one, you'll remember this one, and that is the that flight from Bali that went with a pregnant woman that went supposedly, you know, was going to go to L.A. and then on its way to Chicago, and you know, then all of a sudden she goes into labor, and you look at, you know, and this, you know, made all the newspapers because it was like this miraculous birth, right? Because they had to divert to Alaska. Now, what was interesting about that is on a globe, that flight should have gone straight through Hawaii and through Los Angeles and up to Chicago, but it diverted north to Alaska. It didn't make any sense. They were like maybe 2-3 hours, if you looked at a globe map, 2-3 hours outside of Honolulu, and they go straight up to Anchorage. But if you look on a flat map, which is known in the map projections, and we may or may not get into this, called the azimuthal equidistant map, AZIMUTHL,
yep.
On that map, it's a straight shot from Bali it goes right by Alaska, so it wasn't even a question. They diverted right to it. So, and that's the map I use now.
Yes, I'm a GIS person as well. So, but I thought that was interesting. But yes, thank you for taking my call.
Oh, no worries.
I just pulled up the azimuthal map and I looked at the course from Bali to Chicago, and it almost goes right by the North Pole. It looks like, but it does fly right past Alaska.
Goes right by Alaska, and that's why they stopped there. It's true. The azimuthal equidistant map was, which I did in Clue 3, called The Map Makers.
Right.
And again, I just stumbled. This is not secret information. I just stumbled upon all this stuff in Wiki. And that is the azimuthal map, which is a top-down view of the world. Like if you took a globe and just put your hand on the North Pole and just squished it into the floor, it is really, really interesting because the USGS actually uses it in their USGS map projections of the world. But at the same time, it is also used by the Flat Earth Society, and the bigger one is, if people were wondering what it looks like, it's the UN flag.
Yeah.
It's the UN, but there's something missing.
What's missing? Oh, I hope we didn't lose him. We're going to have to call him back. I'll give him a second to see if he comes back. Oh, it sounds like he's still there.
Oh, no, I'm still here. I wouldn't have dropped off.
There you are. Okay. Anyway, we've got just a minute and a half here before the first break. Caller, what's your name?
Hey, this is Tony.
Tony, hey, man. Can you ask your question in a minute?
Yeah. So, geosynchronous satellites only work within a certain range of the horizon, and if you get down into the Arctic, there's no way to have it geosynchronous and stay over the same place in the Earth. So in order to cover the poles, you have to rotate north and south, and you can't make it stationary. I can elaborate on that more. I fished in Alaska. I've navigated boats. The globe works because that's what it is. And when you get people who are not aware and not able to think critically, then you can snow them with the flat Earth thing. That's my opinion. And we can visit more after the break if you want, and I can elaborate.
Oh, well, why don't you just hold on, and we'll be right back with you, okay?
Uh-huh.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have Mark Sargent on the phone with us today, and we are talking about the idea that maybe the Earth isn't as round as you think it is. We'll be right back after a word from our sponsors, and we'll continue our call with Tony. Stick with us, folks.
Thinking of buying or selling a home? Wouldn't you agree you want experience on your side? Very few realtors possess the experience you deserve, like Marlon Denning, owner and principal broker of Clear Choice Real Estate. I'm Mark Maxon. I've personally worked with Marlon, and I can attest he can help you avoid the pitfalls often associated with the purchase or sale of a property. With Marlon Denning, you're not just working with a part-time agent. You'll work directly with the broker. With his years of experience in real estate, homeowners insurance claims, and general contracting, Marlon Denning has helped hundreds of home buyers and sellers exceed their expectations. Marlon's expertise will provide the leverage you want when negotiating the sale or purchase of your home. Whether you're a first-time home buyer, upgrading, downsizing, or looking for an investment property, Marlon Denning will provide the professional guidance you deserve. Call Marlon Denning today for a free, no-obligation market analysis. 801-652-0056. 801-652-0056. That's 801-652-0056.
Trouble sleeping? Hi, I'm Carl Tobler, owner of Mattress Warehouse. I've been putting Utahns to sleep for 10 years now. If you have trouble sleeping, waking up with a sore back, or you've been feeling tired throughout the day, it could be your mattress. The Mattress Warehouse 6 Wasatch locations carry dependable, quality, name-brand mattresses that will assure you a good night's sleep for years to come. Our Sealy, Serta, and Tempur-Pedic mattresses provide the engineering, selection, and comfort you deserve. And our exclusive Sleep Fit process will help you select the perfect mattress for you. If for any reason you're not thrilled with your new mattress, we'll exchange it for another mattress of your choice up to 120 days after your original purchase. Visit us online at MattressWarehouseUtah.com for a location near you. Then drop in and check out our big sale going on now. We're Gephardt approved, and we guarantee the lowest price on your new mattress, or it's absolutely free.
Save time, save money. Sleep good tonight. MattressWarehouseUtah.com.
The Armory Shooting Range, located at 248 West 9210 South in Sandy, is Utah's newest and largest indoor shooting range. The Armory features 18 climate-controlled lanes with state-of-the-art target carriers and air system. The Armory has a vast selection of rental guns for use on the range, including machine guns. The Armory's facility and firearm training programs are designed with your personal safety and enjoyment as a priority. Many services are offered, including classes, gunsmithing, and a cutting-edge training simulator. Whether you're a beginner or an experienced marksman, the in-depth training, highly qualified instructors, and custom-designed facility will get you to where you want to be as a shooter. Head on in to experience the newest indoor shooting range in the state. Just off the freeway at 248 West 9210 South in Sandy. Online at armoryshootingrange.com or call 801-447-1789. The Armory Shooting Range, just off the freeway at 248 West 9210 South in Sandy.
Are you living with old and ugly carpet? You want new carpet, but it's just too expensive, right? We know what you mean. Introducing $3 Carpet, the most affordable carpet solution on the planet. We save you a ton of money over those box stores because our just-like-brand-new carpet, used for only 2 to 3 days, normally sells for $8 to $10 a yard, with us starting at just $3 a yard. So don't live with that ugly carpet anymore. Our new carpet is so cheap, if you beat our price on a similar carpet, we'll give you $3. Who can do that? Only we can. $3 Carpet. Don't live with that ugly carpet anymore. You save up to 60% with us because you don't pay for expensive overhead like those other stores. In Draper, call now. 801-251-1480. $3carpet.com. 801-251-1480. $3carpet.com. Call today. Attention salespeople. $3 Carpet is currently hiring to help with our high demand. If you're looking for a great sales job with unique and exclusive products, we've got one. Call today. 801-251-1480.
Welcome back to the show, folks. You're listening to Inside the News. This is our taboo conspiracy on Thursday. And we're talking about the idea that a globe idea of the planet, the way you have envisioned the Earth from the schoolroom until now, may be a lie. And we have Mark Sargent on the phone with us. And tell us about your website and your YouTube channel so that people who want to look more into what you're talking about can go there. Are you there, Mark?
I'm here. Sorry about that. My microphone was muted.
Ah, yes. I have the same problem sometimes in the studio
worries.
Here.
But, yeah, the website is enclosedworld.com.
Okay.
And the YouTube channel is Mark K. Sargent. That's M-A-R-K-K, middle initial, and then S-A-R-G-N-T. But you don't even have to look up the YouTube channel. Or you just Google your favorite search engine, type in Flat Earth Clues. If you can't find it, well, then you're probably not using the internet.
All right, we've got the caller Tony here, who wants to continue his question and debate. Tony, you were saying that geosynchronous satellites, right?
So early on, your guest said someone was talking to someone, and they said we're told that the geosynchronous satellites that do the GPS didn't work at the poles, and the guy apparently, unaware of how things work, said, well, why not? So he got an answer that a person who knows tells someone who doesn't know the basics of something that they should be aware of. He said, well, because the Earth is flat, as I heard it. Yep. Well, so this is an inside joke that somebody who knows how they work would tell someone who is apparently wanting to be in the know but hasn't enough background education or information to observe it. So it was a joke on him.
Just to be clear, though, it's not at the poles. Not at both poles. It's just at the South Pole. Not at the North Pole. North Pole works fine.
Okay. So then the South Pole's flat? Elaborate a little more.
I've
navigated boats in the Arctic Ocean. I've been to the Arctic Circle. I've been out to the end of Attu at the end of the Aleutians. And you know what? The navigation system works. You can plot it on a chart or you can get it on GPS. I was out there in the early 90s when LORAN, which was navigation based on shore-based radio stations, was being phased out in favor of a global positioning system from satellites.
This is all in the Northern Hemisphere?
Yeah. And that's perfect. That's an excellent point that he brought up because he knows about the LORAN system, the old defense system that was supposedly in there before they went to the GPS system, also designed by the United States military, and the GPS system, which went online in the mid-90s, designed by the Department of Defense. The GPS system that everybody used to track anything around the world is a U.S. military system. And I looked into that right away when this thing happened because there were people that were telling me that, that the Southern Hemisphere flights were really, really weird and tracking for the GPS was really spotty. So I took a good hard look at the GPS system because you can go online. It's not a big secret and punch it. It all comes with the same database like Flight Tracker or Flight Aware or Flight Radar. And you can track planes because they're way faster than ships. And I noticed that in the Southern Hemisphere, and by that I mean the South Pacific, the South Atlantic, and the Indian Ocean, those planes are not tracked at all by the GPS system. Once they get out of water, once they leave the land, not in the Northern Hemisphere. Northern Hemisphere is fine. Southern Hemisphere, they completely drop off the system entirely, disappear visually and from a data standpoint, and don't come back on until about an hour before landing. And that was really, really odd. And when I looked into it, it was like, wait a minute, did the LORAN system even get dropped entirely? Because people were writing me and calling me, and they're saying it's not that the GPS system is being turned off in the Southern Hemisphere. It may not exist at all. And by that, I'm going to go, I'm not shy about saying it. I'm saying that not only has NASA been the most fraudulent operation ever since it was created in 1958, but everything tied to it, including geosynchronous satellites, including the ISS, the International Space Station, including everything. I'm saying that how you're getting around in the North Pole or around, the Alaskan Islands is all still based on the old LORAN system. They didn't turn it off. The LORAN system is still running. They just put a new sticker on it and said that, oh, yeah, by the way, there's 24 satellites now flying around the Earth in multiple patterns. That's what they say the GPS system is running on. And yet there's these massive gaps. It's a global positioning system. Why would you have three of the biggest oceans in the world not being covered?
Here's my analysis of that. Mm-hmm. LORAN was based on large commercial AM radio stations, as far as I understand it. And when we were navigating with the end of LORAN, it was very spotty and inconsistent. The weather really messed with it, and you could not navigate anywhere near as precisely with LORAN as you can with
GPS.
Yep. And so one skipper that I fished, and so up until a certain time, the GPS signals were scrambled, and you couldn't get closer than probably 100 meters. And he said during the first Gulf War, they unscrambled it, and he said you could dock a boat using the GPS. It was so much closer.
Well,
and the other thing that you have to remember is that they do commercial surveying with GPS stations, and they're remote, and these guys claim an accuracy of some, you know, less than an inch getting a location.
Yeah.
So you can't do that with Loran type systems, which broadcast on a completely different radio wavelength and strength.
Yeah. But at the same time, you're putting a lot of faith in what they claim. Look, I'm not saying the Loran system wasn't boosted. I mean, the Loran system was around for a long, long time. I'm saying it still never went to any sort of satellite system. It's just an enhanced Loran system. And
no, Loran is based on commercial radio stations like KGO in San Francisco. The super, you know, and it is not close navigation, and it acts completely different in different weather. So everything.
But, Tony.
So.
We get your argument.
That's all I've got to say. And if you went to any place that people navigate, either with celestial instruments like sextants, mm-hmm. or with GPS like ocean sailors or airplane navigation, they would laugh at you because you can say there is no science, but there are hundreds of thousands of competent engineers and electronic technicians who say there is. So you probably get traction on a little radio station with people who might be inclined to believe it, but if you went up into anywhere that the technology exists, you're going to spin your wheels.
All right, Tony. Huh? Thanks for your call, bud.
Uh-huh.
And I totally get that. But to his point, I have interviewed in the last 2 months, I have interviewed more people from a professional standpoint that come back and say, yeah, there's nothing that we can do to curb, including a career surveyor. He was mentioning the commercial surveyors. I had a commercial surveyor on just not even 6 weeks ago, and he retired after 32 years. And he says, look, he goes, every surveyor out there works on a flat plane model. They tell you that going into the surveying world. They go, treat the world like it's absolutely flat as a book, and everything will work out fine. But he came back and said, well, if that's the case, though, eventually you're going to have to deal with the curve, because if my book has to match up with the guy next to me's book and this project, and if you're building an entire city, eventually you've got to deal with the curve. And he goes, it's not there. He goes, I shot for 32 years. Never once did the curvature even come up in the conversation. He goes, look, even by accident, we should run into it from a surveying standpoint. And it was never there.
Now, Mark, you've also interviewed, I've seen an interview with a Navy gunner, a submarine pilot.
God. Yeah, I've got the list in front of me. A Navy missile instructor that's trains is currently in it. A U.S. Army artillery radar operator, industrial engineer, flight instructor, a submarine chief. They're all saying the same things over and over. And that is, there's three things that they invariably will bring up, and that is one. They can't find the curve anywhere. That's the big one, because everyone wants to look for it. Two, the Coriolis effect, which means the spinning of the Earth and how it affects, in this case, projectiles, isn't calculated in any of our military things. So if people hear about the sniper stuff, no. I even read a thing, a sniper instructor was out instructing for 3 years. He goes, it's not in the manual. And the third thing is the maps are wrong. And it's incredible. None of these people are contradicting each other. I would expect at least somebody to call me and say, oh, yeah, that guy's full of it. He's not anywhere close. No, they're all saying the same thing. They're all saying, you know what? He goes, I can't believe I didn't see it. And they all have been dominoing next to each other. The missile instructor got the submarine guy. The submarine guy got the surveyor. And the surveyor got the flight instructor. You know, everyone kind of clued in, and they all kind of had that weird revelation where it's like, wait, how do I know the curve's there? Where is it?
Now, one of the most fascinating points for me was the airline pilot issue. If jets traveling at 500 miles per hour, they would have to account for the curvature every minute at 2,777 feet. And airline pilots are saying, we never dip the nose. Mark, in your opinion, what is the most convincing proof of the flat Earth that you could share with us?
The convincing one that I try to, you know, it really varies from person to person, but the one that people seem to gravitate towards more than others is the actual physical curvature, because you can go out and test this anywhere yourself, which is, if you don't know what the curvature is, and people say, well, you know, the Earth's too big, you can't see it side to side, you know, the curvature, if you're looking out on a horizon. That's the argument by the globalists. But the curvature is 8 inches per mile squared. So it's not 8 inches every mile. So it's not like 8th and 16th and 24th and 32.
No, it's a curve.
It's a curve. So at the first mile is 8 inches. The second mile is two miles. 2 times 2 is 4. Times 8 is 32. And then it gets steeper and steeper because eventually it's got to drop off if it's a globe. And
it's exponential.
Exactly. And the problem is that if that's the case, and this isn't flat Earth science, this is regular globe science. You know, that's where we got the equation from. And once you get to a certain distance, you should not be able to see certain objects, even tall objects, because they're down over the hill of the curve. Like, for example, Chicago. Chicago is, from the other side of the lake, is 50 miles. 50 miles on a curve should be about 1,600 to 1,700 feet, you know, depending on where you are there. And there's nothing in the Chicago skyline that's that tall, not even close. You should not see any of the Chicago skyline. And you see pretty much all of it. And with the exception of some atmospheric distortion in the lower parts, and people say, well, it's a mirage. I'm just going, oh.
All right, so from the west coast of Michigan, you can see Chicago.
Yeah. Yeah, people have been taking pictures and videos. There was a weatherman that came out just this year, and you know, he goes, "Oh yeah, this photo was taken." And he goes, "What you're looking at here is actually a mirage."
Well, that's...
and even the weatherman, I don't know if he bought it, but I don't think he understood it either. But at the same time, it's okay, fine. If that's a mirage, then you can't have it both ways. You can't say, "All right, when I see a ship going off in the distance, it looks like it's dropping below the horizon, but that's not a mirage, right?" Now, Chicago's a mirage, but the ship thing, that's not a mirage. No, they're either both mirages or they're both real. And getting back to the point, the curvature is, can you see the curvature when you're looking at objects that are far away?
Everybody claims that they can when I first bring it up.
Sure. Sure, and that's also one of the tests I've said. You know, we won't make this exclusive to people that fly in airplanes. Because people say, oh, well, you know, I'm in an airplane, I look out my seat and I see the curve. I go, really? Fine. Take a picture of it, put it on your laptop, hold a little straight edge up to it, tell me you see a curve. If you still have a curve, you email it to me, and I will talk about it on air. No one. 9 months later, no one's done it.
Yeah.
And it just gets worse and worse. The Navy instructor guy, I'll take even a further one. He says, look, I'm shooting a 2-inch beam radar out at 50 nautical miles, which is about 58 land miles. He goes, that should be several thousand feet below the curvature, and we're painting targets. And, you know, we're painting ships at that level. You know, that's ship-to-ship level, so it's not like we're going from a hill and going down at an angle or anything.
Well, isn't there any relativity that's involved with this?
No. Even if there was, if someone comes at me with relativity, I'm going to destroy them, because it's like, okay, if it's relative, then it's a constant. So you're saying that at that point, you're saying what, a beam radar can go as far as it wants?
Yes.
You know, what's this? You know, you can't tell me it's perfectly arcing at 60 miles.
Right.
You know,
right. Gravity,
they're going to pull it down into the water, or, you know, right away, or it's not going to pull anything. And there's so many little things that science is just breaking down. Again, I'm not anti-science.
So why are we so quick to explain it away, even though our explanation is crazier than a flat Earth theory?
Why is everyone so quick to say, no, it's a globe, that sort of thing?
Yeah.
Because it's in our head. It's always been in our head. For the last 500 years, there's so much globe reinforcement. And honestly, you know, and I talked about this in the clues, I don't think even the authority, and by that, you know, the super rich, the governments, or the royals, I don't even think the people that run this world knew officially until 1956. I think they were looking for it with the whole Admiral Byrd story when he went out to Antarctica.
Let's get into Admiral Byrd when we come back, okay? Because we've got to go to a break. We've got Mark Sargent on. We're talking about the idea that the Earth is not as much of a globe as you think it is. Right after these messages, we'll be right back. I've got somebody who's been waiting 20 minutes to talk to you, Mark.
Okay.
This is fantastic. We'll be right back, folks.
Who's got the inside intel on what's hot, what's happening, and what's uniquely Utah in your neighborhood? You do. The List is a Utah-exclusive publication supporting our dynamic and thriving incubator of entrepreneurs, solopreneurs, and the communities that support the best that local businesses have to offer. We want you to write for The List. Send us a review of what you think makes Utah unique. Contact us at www.thelistut.com for more information.
I'm smiling because I can enjoy my life again without worrying about the IRS or how I'm going to support my family. My friends told me about TaxDebtPros.com, a local Utah full-service tax resolution company. The professionals at TaxDebtPros.com did a free case analysis and explained everything to me clearly in a language I can understand. They got right to work, and now I'm paying a small portion of what I did before. The best part is I got my life and smile back.
Do you have IRS problems? The local experts at TaxDebtPros.com assist business owners and individuals in resolving tax issues. They can help reduce your tax debt and penalties, assist with IRS audits, stop wage garnishment, tax liens and levies, and prepare unfiled tax returns. Get help now. TaxDebtPros.com will completely handle your case with the IRS and take your stress away so you can start smiling again. Visit them online at TaxDebtPros.com or call them today, 801-878-0363, to schedule your free case analysis.
For some, the Festival of Trees has been a tradition for generations. For others, the Festival of Trees is a tradition waiting to begin. Enjoy 800 decorated Christmas trees, wreaths, centerpieces, gingerbread creations, playhouses, and quilts. Satisfy your sweet tooth with candies, cakes, scones, and sweet rolls. There are activities especially for children, live entertainment, and shopping for gifts. Santa will be there too. The most important part of the Festival of Trees is that every penny raised benefits children at Primary Children's Hospital. Doors open Wednesday, December 2nd through Saturday, December 5th from 10 a.m. to 10 p.m. at Southtown Expo Center. Tickets available at the door. $6 per adults, $3 per children ages 2 through 11, $5 per senior citizen. Wednesdays is Family Day, where $18 admits up to 6 immediate family members. Discount tickets can be purchased at most Zions Bank branches. For more information, visit festivaloftreesutah.org.
Welcome back to the show, folks. Inside the News, 43 minutes after the hour. We have just 14 and a half minutes left with Mark Sargent this morning. We were talking about Admiral Byrd. Before we do that, there was a phone call that said, knocked illucent clouds. I don't know why he brought those up. But the, you know, really high up in the atmosphere, the water ice crystals that you can see at night sometimes.
Sure.
Do you know why he brought that up?
Well,
okay.
No, I don't. I mean, but he could ask. Is he still on to ask the question?
No, he's not on the air anymore. He did mention I'm going to go up to King's Peak and see Everest from it. Then,
yeah.
7,000 miles away. Can you see through 7,000 miles of atmosphere?
No, of course not. Which, even, anyways, by the way, it's part of the arguments. And that is, if you take a big telescope and you turn it horizontal, can you see thousands of miles? And it's like, no, the atmosphere is got way too many problems to see that far. I mean, you got to remember, the atmosphere we live in is not that much different than water. You know, it's just different chemicals, but you still got to look through it, and it's going to get blurry at a distance, plus you're going to be looking through weather systems. So okay. If you want, you can email me the question. I don't know what it's got to do with this. What I'm saying, though, is that to boil it down real quick, is that if you saw the movie The Truman Show, the 1998 movie with Jim Carrey, the argument is, that movie was based on a structure, a Hollywood structure that was, you know, maybe 20 miles wide and very ambitious. You know, could you fool a person inside a structure into saying the world was whatever you wanted to? And of course you could. You could do the same thing in a planetarium now to raise a child in it. But if you had the ability, if you had the technological ability to make that structure thousands of miles wide, could you fool an entire civilization?
Now, Mark, one of the common questions I always hear on the subject is they don't really understand what the flat Earth model looks like. They just they don't get it. I mean, where's Antarctica?
Oh, yeah, because visually it goes against our very sensibility, no question. The flat Earth model looks like, if you ever get a chance, you can look at it on Wikipedia. Just look up the azimuthal, A-Z-I-M-U-T-H-A-L, equidistant map. or look at the UN flag. That's basically it from a literal standpoint. And that is, it is the North Pole is in the, think of a dinner plate. The North Pole is in the center. The continents are kind of spread out on the outside. And then Antarctica, the only thing that's completely different on that map is Antarctica isn't this continent that looks kind of like Australia. At the bottom, it is spread out around the entire outer edge, like a big ring of ice. And that's part of the Admiral Byrd mystery, because he was trying to explore that thing for 30 years.
So did he just run into the wall?
Well, that's just it. Okay, real quick, I'll give you the real short version of Admiral Byrd. Admiral Byrd, United States Navy's greatest admiral, in my opinion, youngest admiral at age 41.
He was quite the prolific, he was a celebrity.
Oh, yeah, yeah. He went around and did tours and talked to a lot of people and was interviewed a whole bunch of times, and mostly because of exploring. He did the North Pole in a rickety plane in 1926, and then he was sent down to Antarctica in 1928. And from 1928, literally up until his death in 1957, he was exploring Antarctica. And around there, he just kept going back mission after mission for 30 years, and it didn't make any sense. What was he looking for, right? And he goes on television in 1954, and you can look this up. This is up on YouTube. You can look up Admiral Byrd interview. There's a CBS interview from 1954. It's excellent quality.
That crazy title of that TV show, what was it called?
Oh, it's called the Long Jeans Chronoscope, which is L-O-N-G-I-N-E-S, Chronoscope. I think it was a watch company.
Yeah, I've seen the video.
And he goes on television in 1954, and he says, look, he goes, Antarctica is going to be huge. And by that, he meant scientifically and economically. He goes, the place is made out of money. He goes, there's an entire mountain range made out of coal. There's oil. There's minerals. There's uranium. Everyone's going to be down there. We're going to be doing missions every year. And there's all these countries that are down there doing stuff. And that was in 1954. And he's prepping for the next mission, which turned out to be his last in 1955, called Operation Deep Freeze. And he goes, yeah, we're getting ready for our next expedition. We're getting everything ready. And that is one thing you do, you know. So he tells all the corporations of the world, yeah, we're going to make a ton of money down there. And then he goes down for his next mission. And then...
Is that how he got funding then?
He was obviously funded by both the United States government and whoever else, you know, the elites were, they wanted him to find something. And even he, I think, was giving up after 30 years. Because if you look for something for 30 years, whatever it is, you know, they say, well, the Earth is flat, and they're trying to look for the barrier, the edge, and you don't find it, it's like sooner or later, it's like, you know what, let's just make money. And so that's what it looked like. And then, of course, Murphy's Law, he goes down there after it was on television, and whatever they found, and for me, it was, you know, obvious what they found. He found the barrier or the indications of it. Whatever was down there, some sort of wall. What it's made out of, we don't know. After that, the world changed permanently, and most people don't know the history behind that. And that is everybody that was on the ice at the same time. We're talking the United Kingdom, Russia, Argentina, Chile, New Zealand, Australia. They were all down there. They all left the ice like they stole something. And an Antarctic Treaty was put in place in 1959, and it still exists to this day, which says no corporation, no matter how much money you make, anywhere, can do work down. You cannot go down to Antarctica and make money on this, ever. And it went against everything that we know we are as a capitalistic...
Seriously?
Civilization, yeah. They sealed it off from... It started in 1959. The treaty isn't even up for review until 2041. What treaty? And everyone unilaterally signed it. All the nations that were down there. Not only that, but when you become an economic power, let's say you create a brand new country called, Flatlandia, and you create this country, you have to sign. Oh, yeah, by the way, they'll put this in front of you. They say, by the way, you got to sign this Antarctic Treaty. And you say, what does it mean? It means you can't go down to Antarctica and do anything, ever. And
wow.
Yeah, no, they sealed it off entirely. And then after that, he dies in 1957 for whatever reason. I'd like to think that it wasn't nefarious purposes. Maybe he died of natural causes. Or maybe they figured, well, you know, he's going to be doing TV interviews. People are going to be talking to him. We can't have him do that. He's pretty affable on camera. You know, maybe we shouldn't let him do it. But after that, everything, you know, the United States and Russia immediately started their rocket programs, which made sense because, of course, if you find the outer edge, you can try to find the upper edge. They started firing nukes straight up a year after they started the rocket program, fired nukes for 4 years, from 1958 until 1962. This is all public knowledge. You can look it up anywhere. It's on Wiki. One of the nuke packages was called Operation Fishbowl, which makes no sense at all. It's like, why are we, if you're shooting rockets straight up in the air with atomic weapons, why are you calling it Operation Fishbowl? And then during that, those nuke tests, NASA's formed in 1958, right after the nukes start. And then in 1959, mysteriously, and this is, again, if you believe in coincidences, they announced the Van Allen radiation belts at the exact same time that they announced that the Antarctic treaty is in place. So they seal off the upper edge and the outer edge at the same time. They say, oh, yeah, there's a band of radiation up there. No one should ever go there, ever, ever, ever. And then NASA militarizes the sky. Everything that happens above commercial air traffic has to go through NASA. If you think I'm kidding, you look up who, you know, the Japanese Space Agency, European, the Russians, everything goes through NASA or the AST, the Aeronautical Space and Transportation Bureau out of Washington, D.C., also run by NASA. They control everything. They are the ones that are telling you what space is, which is why I have to circle back to the questions. Like, how do you know you are where you think you are? Because the gatekeepers are all the same people, and that is NASA. I know I'd pick on them because of the highest profile, but they're the ones that are telling you everything that's out there. When you hear a story about Mars or Jupiter or Pluto, you know, all the stuff that's going on, it's all about NASA. You gotta, and they have a lot of gaps. And I know we don't have a ton of time, but and I know you probably got questions. But one of the big ones is, other than the Van Allen radiation belts, which they still haven't explained how they got through 10 missions from Apollo 8 through Apollo 17 through, is why they only took one full picture of the Earth from 1972 to July of this year, July of 2015. Why was there a 43-year gap between pictures? There should be thousands and thousands of satellites up there. And speaking of which, when you say, well, there's thousands and thousands of satellites up there, I go, really? Who told you there were satellites up there? Was it the same guy that told you they went to the moon? Because if you looked at the moon footage lately, it has not aged well. It has aged about the same pace as Gilligan's Island, which happened to be shot at about the same time. There's too many gaps. I look at the Van Allen radiation belt, and I cannot wait until I get run into an astrophysicist, because they've already lost in this case. It's just a matter of time now. How did they get past the Van Allen radiation belts? If they're that deadly, there's only two types of shielding you could put on a capsule. One is lead, the other is gold, and they're both really, really heavy.
And you need a lot of it.
You need a lot of it. How did you make 10 round trips through that belt to the moon and back? Nobody died. Nobody got radiation poisoning. The capsules weren't contaminated.
Hey, Tom Hanks almost died.
Yeah, exactly. I'll throw that one into you, too. And that is, all right, you don't buy any of that, fine. How come there's no movies about the moon missions? 50 years, Hollywood, if there's a nickel to be made, Hollywood will make a movie of it. No one's ever made a movie about a moon mission. Think
Transformers.
About Transformers, an actual non-science fiction. And no, you can't use Moon, the movie about clones that are mining on the moon.
Okay.
The closest we ever came was like Apollo 18, which wasn't even a real mission. And it was about little rock monsters that were on the moon. There's no real movies about the moon. Tom Hanks created an HBO series called From the Earth to the Moon in 1998. And that was the last time anyone's ever even talked about it. People say, oh, well, the right stuff in 1983. It's like, No, the right stuff was just an astronaut recruiting program. They never went anywhere. The end of the movie, they went to low Earth orbit. I was in the theater when that came out. I thought, well, that's a kind of a rip. Where's the sequel? Sequel was never made. Easiest sequel to make in the world, never happened.
Let's get some calls in before the end of the show, Mark.
Sure, sorry.
No, that's go ahead, caller. You've been waiting a while. What's your name?
Hi, Catherine.
Oh, Catherine. Okay, go ahead, hon.
Hi, first of all, thanks, all of you researchers, for all of this work you do. I would not be so brave to come out and tell the world you think the world is flat. And I have two questions. First of all, Mark, what do you think the moon is? We've talked about the Earth being flat. Can you address what you think flat Earth cosmology is? What are the sun and moon?
Okay.
And my second question or comment is, physics says that water must seek its own level. So where's the Pacific Ocean level?
Perfect.
So I'm asking about the moon and the Pacific, please.
Catherine, thank you so much for holding in for your question.
You're welcome.
Yeah, those are great questions. Okay, first off, the cosmology, real fast. If we're in a giant stage, a giant planetarium, as it were, the stars are just a light show, basically up on the ceiling, like it would be in a planetarium. However, the moon and the sun appear to be different. They appear to be some sort of three-dimensional objects that are way, way smaller and way, way closer. The sun is not 93 million miles away, and the moon is not 237,000 miles away. They are roughly the same size, maybe, I don't know, 30 miles in diameter, maybe, I'm just guessing here. But they are physical objects with something projected on top of them. And again, the time is short, so let me say this real quick. And that is, you want to know what the moon is, take a look at the YouTube video series on lunar waves, shot by a great guy named Crow777. And he took some HD camera footage of the moon, and he found what appeared to be a resolution issue where there's a refresh rate that's actually rippling through the moon. And I come from a gaming background. I look at this and I'm going, wait a minute, why is there a resolution issue with the moon? Wait a minute, why am I even saying that? It doesn't make any sense unless the moon is not what you think it is. Yeah, there's something underneath it, but I think that it's projecting something on its skin. The craters and everything you see there, that is not what the moon really is. It's whatever it is underneath it, we don't know yet, but hopefully we'll find out soon. The Pacific Ocean, excellent point, and that is water seeks its own level. And that is, yeah, on a sphere, if you believe in space as it is, water clings to the outside. Yeah, and that's great, fine. Maybe if the sphere isn't spinning, the water may hold uniformly on it, like gravity, that's what they explain. However, we are spinning, supposedly. So if we're spinning at 1,000 miles an hour and water will find its own level, then why aren't the oceans being pulled down from the North and South Pole ever so, even slightly? There shouldn't be oceans on the very top and the very bottom. The water should, because centrifugal force, remember, like a merry-go-round, is going to try to pull you off. At the equator, spinning at 1,000 miles an hour, it does not take much to move water. There should be the water, the ocean should be very, very thick.
No, gravity, gravity's holding it there, Mark.
Quickly address the tidal issue?
I would love to address more. I've got 7 seconds before we go to break, and I didn't want to stop you. I'd love to have more. I hope you'll be on the show again.
Yeah, let me know. I'd love to talk.
Mark, thank you so much for being with us and for giving us that hour this morning. It's just absolutely fascinating.
Thank you very much.
And anybody who wants to see Mark Sargent's material, go to enclosedworld.com.
World.com. Flat Earth Clues. That's probably the easiest way.
Yeah, just type in Flat Earth Clues on YouTube, and you'll get all the videos there. Or you'll get directed to a site through Google. Okay, so what a show. Thank you, John, for everything you did to help prepare for this.
And thank you, Mark.
Thank you again, Mark. And everybody, we will be back next Thursday with more conspiracy. We'll announce what the topic is a little bit later. Have a great day, everybody, and thanks for listening.